There it stands, the round sphere. It stands not at the northernmost point of the European continent, nor is it on the northernmost point of the northernmost island of Europe. Nevertheless, everyone wants to go there, the German caravanists as well as the British crusaders and the Italian easy riders. I also follow this call, because here the Eurovelo 1, the Atlantic coast cycle route across Europe, starts. It goes from the North Cape to Sagres in southern Portugal, crosses 9 countries and is 8,186 kilometers long. To get there, I choose the flight to Kirkenes as a first step. This place in the outer Finnmark is located very close to the Russian border. It is historically very interesting, even if all buildings are functional and from the post-war period. When my father traveled with me at the age of 14 to Norway, he warned me that Norwegians had reservations about Germans, even if I never experienced them. Here, in Kirkenes, one learns that they had all reason for it. Kirkenes was bombed 385 times during the Second World War. During this time, the Underskrotta served the population as protection bunkers.
Wertvoll macht und der hat ihn ja genau 50 Jahre nachdem Bjørnevatn und Kirkenes befreit wurden unterzeichnet, da war er hier. Die beiden Städte wurden am 25. Oktober 1944 ja befreit. Und die Unterschrift, die ist eine späte Anerkennung für diejenigen, die während dem Zweiten Weltkrieg als Partisanen hier im Einsatz waren.
Today Kirkenes, which is located in the transition zone from taiga to tundra, is the overpriced northern terminal of the Hurtigruten. There's even a slight Russian influence in the village. Today the border is largely closed, after bicycle migration had been possible for some time. The Hurtigruten ship which takes me to the North Cape Island is the King Harald. It is large and very comfortable, and it does not matter at all that I do not travel cabin class.
When the southbound you hear the MS King Harald is soon ready for departure. On behalf of Captain Eliasson and his crew, we would like to welcome our new guests aboard. We kindly ask you to set the ship safety information which is shown on TV monitors and
on the way to the North Cape Island, the ship sails up the Varanger Fjord and then stops at 5 small remote ports. The encounter with an approaching Hurtigruten ship is roundly celebrated. In the light of the midnight sun, we pass the Nordkinn Peninsula. Its northern end is actually the northernmost mainland point of continental Europe. The following day, at 6 o'clock in the morning, we reach Honigsvåg. It is the landing stage from which the North Cape is reached. The wind refreshed markedly during the night, but I mount my bicycle and head towards the North Cape. 30 kilometers are only a stone's throw. As I cycle up the serpentines to the plateau, the storm gets very strong and nearly blows me into a caravan. I have no other choice but to turn back. I lodge at the Nordkap camping and after narrowly losing my tent, I rent a hut. The next morning, together with another German cyclist, who also had returned because of the storm, I make a second attempt to reach the North Cape. The weather is gorgeous, sunshine, blue sky, and a gentle breeze. This is a rare pleasure for my fellow cyclist as well, since he had come up all the way from southernmost Norway and had often cycled through pouring rain. After reaching the plateau, it is another 20 kilometers to the North Cape. Even if it is not the northernmost point of the North Cape Peninsula, which lies 3 kilometers further west on the rock cliff Knivskneljorden, it is visited by up to 260,000 visitors a year. The entrance fee of 30 euros does not apply to long-distance cyclists, which enhances the view over the World Sphere model and the Norwegian Sea. The words of the Italian priest Francesco Negro of Ravenna, a forefather of the North Cape tourism, come to mind. He traveled from Ravenna to the North Cape in 1664 and wrote in his diary, "Here I stand at the North Cape, the uttermost point of Finnmark. I could even say that this is the end of the entire world, as no point farther north is inhabited by people. My thirst for knowledge is now sated, and I will return to Denmark and, God willing, to the land of my birth." After the two of us had conquered the North Cape by bike, the following day we set off to discover the depth of the earth. To reach the Norwegian mainland, we had to traverse two tunnels. The first is the 4,440 meters long Hunniksvak tunnel. The second, the almost 7 kilometers long North Cape tunnel. This underwater tunnel descends with 10% down to a depth of more than 200 meters, and the 3 kilometer climb to get out of it again is no mean feat. In the tunnel it is cold, windy and very noisy, but the tunnel is very well lit and if necessary one can push the bike on the side strip. A kind of limbo, as sometimes described in the net, it is certainly not. After traversing the North Cape Tunnel, we follow the road 69 to the south. It runs along the west bank of the Porsanger Fjord. With a length of 123 kilometers, this is the longest fjord in northern Norway and the fourth longest in Norway. The landscape is rough and subarctic. The weather is overcast and cool. In the barren landscape, there are nearly no villages or resting places. It is empty except for tourists, seagulls and reindeer. Although we miss the sunshine of yesterday, the weather gives us a special bonus. A very strong backwind. Together with a good road and the few gradients, it turns our bicycles into electric bikes and we make very good progress. So we decide to go to Oldefjord. That are 110 kilometers, but with the backwind it is really no problem. Around 7 o'clock p.m. we reach Olderfjord. There we lodge in a wooden hut on the Rosenes campsite and cook a large pot of noodles for dinner. The next morning, I leave my fellow bike traveler and continue to Hammerfest. It goes westwards and up into the Finnmarksvidda, meaning I have to overcome 250 meters of altitude. Up here, it is even more rough and lonely than on the coastal road. However, I'm not the only tourist that is traveling here. I even pass a lady with a pedal scooter. After about 30 kilometers, I reach Skaidi, where I enjoy a second breakfast. Now I am back on the fjordland, but on the Norwegian west coast. The road leads along the Repparfjord to Kvalsund. Here I cross the northernmost suspension bridge of the world. It spans 750 meters and leads to the island of Kvalo, where Hammerfest is situated. For 30 kilometers, the road runs along the coast. The landscape is impressive, and especially nice for cyclists are the small side roads which lead around the tunnels which are blocked for bicycle traffic. In the late afternoon, I reach Hammerfest, the northernmost city in the world. If you go by urban geography, this is more than doubtful, but anyway, it sounds good. The heraldic animal of Hammerfest is the polar bear, which walks as a statue in front of the city panorama. In Hammerfest, I visit a Saturday evening mass in St. Michael, the northernmost Catholic church in the world. German youth build it within the framework of Aktion Sühnezeichen. Afterwards, I visit the Lutheran Cathedral, which is the landmark of Hammerfest. It was rebuilt after 1945 because the German Wehrmacht had completely destroyed Hammerfest. Then I cycled to the Fuglenes Peninsula. Here are the remains of a 200-year-old fort, and the meridian column stands in the light of the midnight sun. From Hammerfest, I take the other day the Hurtigruten ship to the Vesterålen. As impressive as the subarctic landscape can be, the 250 kilometers I have traveled are enough for me. I do not need the experience of another 600 kilometers. The ship arrives at Tromsø at midnight. With 60,000 inhabitants, Tromsø is the largest city in northern Norway. and it is considered its most beautiful one. In a midnight city tour, I look at the port and the city center, with the old cathedral built entirely of wood. The next morning, the ship reaches the Vesterålen. This archipelago is located in the northeast of the Lofoten. My goal is Stokmarknes on Hadsel, the southernmost Vesterålen island. Stokmarknes is the birthplace of the Hurtigruten, where Captain Wirt founded the Vesterålen Damskibsgesällskap, which from the year 1891 served the route Trondheim-Hammerfest, whatever the weather. In Stokmarknes, the Hurtigruten Museum is located, and I visited the following day. The main attraction is the older Hurtigruten ship Finnmark from the 60s, which forms part of the museum.
And made Norway famous as the land of the midnight sun. It is not without reason that the service was called the most beautiful voyage in the world.
After the visit to the museum, I go to Melbu on the south side of the island. From there, the ferries to the Lofoten Islands leave. On the way, I visit the Hadsel Church, an octagonal wooden building from the 19th century. Unfortunately, it is locked. Too bad. I would have liked to see the altar dating back to the year 1520. The port of Melbu is a tiny village, but I can buy something to eat while I wait for the ferry. The weather is fantastic, but with only 15 degrees, a bit chilly. The crossing to Fiskebøl on the Lofoten Islands takes only half an hour. Vagan, the northernmost island of the Lofoten, presents itself as in an advertising video for Norwegian tourism. I do not take the main road, but cycle westwards along a narrow side road. In this direction, Sandsletta Camping, my destination, is situated. I pass beautiful sandy beaches and the largest dune landscape in the Lofoten. I follow the Norwegian National Bicycle Route number 1, which most of the time is identical with the Jurvalle 1. The National Bicycle Route is often signposted in the Lofoten Islands, although it rarely is a separate bike path. The designation Jurvalle 1 is nowhere to be seen. Are the Norwegians afraid of copyright infringement? In view of the Norwegian contribution to the EU, this seems an abstruse idea. Anyway, it would have been nice to see the Jurvalle 1 sign at least once. From Sandsletta Camping, I cycle the next day to Svolvær. These are only 30 kilometers, but I plan to make a boat trip to the Trollfjord in the afternoon. Only by boat this extremely narrow fjord can be reached. Before my boat trip starts, I visit the Vagar church between Svolvær and Kabelvåg, which is also known as the Lofoten Cathedral. Built in 1898 in Neo-Gothic style, it is the largest wooden church in northern Norway. The Trollfjord is about 30 kilometers from Svolvær near Raftsund. Since it is one of the main tourist attractions of the Lofoten Islands, it is visited every day by several excursion boats. In the summer, even the big ships of the Hurtigruten go into the fjord. The entrance to the Trollfjord is just 100 meters wide, and at its widest point it measures 800 meters. The mountains on its sides rise partially, almost vertically, over 1,000 meters. At the end of the 19th century, the so-called Battle of the Trollfjord took place here, which involved a bitter conflict between the simple Lofoten fishermen and one of the big steamship owners. The fishermen gained free access to the fish swarms in the Trollfjord, and this privilege was later confirmed by the Norwegian parliament. From Vagar, I start the island hopping to the south end of the Lofoten archipelago. In most cases, there are connecting bridges, but once again, I have to pass through a long submarine tunnel. First, I drive to the northwest of Vagar, where I cross over using a bridge to the island of Gimsøya. I cycle along its north coast and cross over another bridge to Vestvagøya. Since I started early, the streets are quite empty. I'm also already traveling in the off-season period, which starts in Norway at the 15th of August. Because I want to visit the Viking Museum at Båstad, I cross Vestvagøy from the northwest to the southeast. The museum includes a large area. Main attraction is a replica of a longhouse. About 800 years ago, this was the seat of the local Viking chief. During excavations, it was proved that the original building had been about 80 meters long. Today, one can see exhibitions of artifacts and demonstrations of traditional techniques, such as belt weaving, in the reconstructed dormitories. In the outdoor area, not only Viking ships, but also livestock of the time are shown. From Vestvagøy, I use the underwater Nabstraumen tunnel to reach the island of Flakstad. The tunnel is 1,780 meters long and the gradient is steep. I'm glad when I'm out of it. In the west of Flakstad, I spend the night on a campsite on the coast. The weather is very nice, but there is a gusty wind that drags on my tent for half of the night. Early the next morning, I cycle southwards on the E10. The ride takes me past the beautiful sandy beaches of Flagstad. Finally, I cross the Kakerensund with the help of two short bridges. Now I am on Moskenes, the southernmost large island of the Lofoten archipelago. It has the steepest mountain peaks and the deepest cut fjords. The E10 runs as a narrow band on the southeast coast to Åre, the place with the shortest name in the world. There all streets end. The fairly frequent tunnels are particularly picturesque for cyclists, not because one would be in danger of being pushed by a caravan to the wall, but because most of them are closed to cyclists. There are beautiful bypaths which run directly on the coast and are surfaced. These give excellent views of the coast landscape. And the enjoyment is of course increased by the knowledge that these views are denied to the motorized travelers. In the early afternoon I reach Rheine, the place with the most spectacular location on Moskenes. Surrounded by mountain peaks between the sea and the fjord, this fishing village with 600 inhabitants has become a tourist landmark of the Lofoten archipelago. From here, it is another 10 kilometers to Åre, where the roads end and one can only continue by foot or mountain bike. After looking at this place, which is still quite touristy even in the post-season, I return and pitch my tent at the campsite near Moskenes. The weather is lovely. 4 days on the Lofoten Islands without a single drop of rain. This surely is record-breaking. It is a big question whether my next leg, the coastal route through Helgeland, will come anywhere near it.